No one can predict the future, but it's reasonable to assume that we can at least predict how we will react to different future scenarios. Unfortunately though, research suggests that we aren't too good at predicting our future emotional reactions either. The legendary Russian director Andrei Tarkovsky weaves a beautiful parable in his masterpiece Stalker, which deals with the question, do we really know what makes us happy? A stalker is a guide who takes people through the zone, a mysterious and forbidden territory in the wilderness guarded by barbed wire and soldiers. Inside the zone, there is the room which is said to grant one's deepest wish to anybody who enters it. Two men, a writer and a professor, enlist the help of stalker to visit the restricted area in hopes of finding inspiration and enlightenment. But as it turns out, you do not ask for your wish loudly or even consciously. The room probes your mind and fulfills your greatest desire, a desire so deep and buried within your mind that you don't even truly know that you want it. One previous man who found the room, the stalker's mentor Porcupine, went in hoping to bring his dead brother back to life, only for the room to present him with a vast sum of money instead, his true inner desire. Porcupine left the zone a rich man, but not long after, he killed himself because he could not live with the shame and guilt of finding out what truly makes him happy. The unawareness about what makes us happy leads to errors in predicting our future emotional states. In this video, I will take a closer look at the implications and causes of these prediction errors, and I will conclude by discussing some strategies to manage their impact on our decisions. If you like the video, remember to press the like button, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment. And now, without any further ado, let's get started. Affective forecasts are people's predictions about their own emotional reactions to future events. Researchers have observed that people routinely mispredict how much pleasure or displeasure future events will bring, and as a result, sometimes work to bring about events that are not the best outcomes for themselves. Affective forecasting consists of four types of predictions: whether we'll feel good or bad, what exact emotion will we feel, how intensely will we feel it, and how long will it last. Turns out we are quite accurate at predicting the valence and specific emotions we'll feel in the future, but less accurate at predicting the intensity of these emotions and least accurate at predicting how long these emotions will last. The most common form of affective misforecasting is impact bias, wherein we overestimate the intensity and duration of our emotional reactions to future events. For example, expecting that a positive event will enable us to live happily ever after, or that a negative event will ruin everything. The tendency to overestimate impact is higher for negative events than positive ones. But regardless of the event, in most cases, life returns to normal very soon, something that we've all experienced, but keep forgetting. Let's find out why. To understand affective misforecasting better, let's start by looking at its cognitive causes, which are the psychological mechanisms that explain the bias. Affective forecasting can be broken down into three underlying cognitive mechanisms. Firstly, we either mentally construct the future scenario or recall past events that the future scenario might resemble. This is known as prospecting. Next, we feel certain emotions in response to this imagined future, and these are referred to as anticipatory effect or pre-motions. And finally, we apply adjustments and corrections to the simulated emotional responses to predict how we'll respond when the event actually occurs. Now, each of these cognitive processes have their own set of limitations which contribute to affective misforecasting. Let's start with prospecting. Firstly, while mentally constructing or imagining the future scenario, we may focus only on the event and not on other things that may also happen at the same time and impact our emotions. Or we may imagine only a single way that the event might happen and not account for many other ways it might unfold, which may lead to different emotions. Next, when we use our memory of similar experiences to make the forecast, we may focus too much on the high and low points of the experience and the feeling it ended with, and ignore large parts of the experience, including its duration. Memories also fade with time, and then we make up some of the details based on our expectations and beliefs. Also, unusual past events stand out in our memory, thus creating a bias in the direction of atypical and unusual experiences. Now let's move on to pre-motions, or the in-the-moment feelings during prospecting. The emotions felt by imagining the future scenario may get contaminated with unrelated emotions felt at the time of forecasting. Now, if we are in an intensely emotional or hot state at the time of forecasting, like angry, hungry, in pain, or aroused, we may experience difficulty in imagining that we will eventually cool off and thus end up overestimating the intensity and duration of our future emotional responses. Conversely, when we are in a cold or unemotional state and forecast for a hot state, we may underestimate our emotional intensity and overestimate our self-control in that scenario. Next, we may use effective forecasting for functional purposes. For example, if we are feeling down at the time of forecasting, we may inadvertently imagine a positive future outcome to feel better. Furthermore, as the future event draws closer, we may be motivated to prepare for the worst-case scenario by underestimating the impact of a positive outcome and overestimating the impact of a negative one. And finally, let's look at sources of errors in our adjustments and corrections while forecasting. The failure to appreciate differences between prediction and experience underlies most cases of insufficient correction. Firstly, we tend to overestimate the extent to which our future experience of an event will resemble our current or past experience of the same event. Secondly, we often focus on insignificant details of the future scenario, or we focus too much on the differences between alternatives and not their commonalities. That means that we often fail to consider the criteria that will have a real impact on our experiences. We may also have inaccurate theories and beliefs about which future outcomes contribute to our happiness and satisfaction. These theories are usually learned in situations where they are valid, but then are overgeneralized to situations where they aren't. Next, we have a tendency to rationalize or explain away unexpected events, thus reducing their emotional power, and this is especially true for negative events. One reason we may mispredict the intensity and duration of negative experiences is that we fail to take into account the fact that our psychology works to minimize the discomfort caused by negative experiences. And lastly, as memory is often unreliable, we may not notice that we've made a forecasting error, as we may misremember our forecast as being consistent with our experience. And even when we do recognize the forecasting errors, the lessons that we take away from it may be specific to that situation rather than general. Moreover, we may reinterpret actual experiences in line with our initial forecast to minimize the psychological discomfort of misprediction. Now, let's look at what's going on in the brain when we make effective forecasts. Default mode network, a system involved in imagination, mind wandering, episodic memory, and future thinking, has been found to play a key role in prospecting and pre-motions. Key nodes of default mode network involved in forecasting include, firstly, hippocampus, which is linked to long-term episodic or autobiographical memory. Secondly, posterior cingulate cortex, which mediates interactions between episodic memory, emotions, and motivations. And lastly, medial prefrontal cortex, which is linked to decision-making and emotional regulation. In essence, system 2 or the prefrontal cortex determines how system 1, consisting of brain regions involved in emotions and memory, will react in the future by tricking it into reacting in the present. Next, let's look at how systematic forecasting errors like impact bias can often be advantageous. Firstly, overestimating emotional impact can amplify and reinforce motivation for behaviors which are important for our survival, well-being, and success. For instance, overestimating the impact of future sadness about an undesirable outcome may increase our motivation to pursue other options in order to avoid those negative feelings. Secondly, impact bias may help us in delaying gratification, that is, foregoing rewards in the present in favor of better rewards in the future, by exaggerating the positive emotions associated with the reward in the future. Next, being unaware of our ability to emotionally recover from negative experiences may function to keep us motivated to avoid those negative experiences rather than becoming complacent about them. And lastly, exaggerating the impact of future positive experiences can help us cope with and recover from unpleasant experiences in the present and the past. Now, let's take a closer look at some of the undesirable impacts of effective misforecasting. Firstly, we wish for and work towards events that we believe will cause us lasting happiness and not just a moment's pleasure. But if we overestimate how long our pleasure will last, we might end up working towards the wrong things. Similarly, we tend to believe that major traumas will have more enduring emotional impact than smaller problems will. But counterintuitively, minor problems that we ignore to fix, like loose hinges or leaky faucets, can annoy us for months or years, while we may adapt quicker and better to major problems than we expect. For example, people experiencing chronic illness or disability are happier than what healthy people predict they would be under similar circumstances. Even loss aversion, wherein we try to avoid losses more than seek gains, may be a result of misforecasting the negative emotional impact of losses. Studies show that people actually recover pretty quickly from the displeasure of losses. Next, when we make a decision that is difficult to reverse, like buying something that cannot be returned or marrying, we are strongly motivated to psychologically justify the decision and make the best of it. But when we can more easily undo a decision, we are less motivated to rationalize that choice because we can always change our minds. Therefore, we often end up being happier with irreversible choices because our psychology does the work necessary to rationalize the choice that can't be undone. But because we are unaware of the psychological mechanism, we often avoid binding commitments that can actually increase our satisfaction. Indeed, we often make efforts and bear costs to seek variety in future choices, but end up picking the same alternative every time we actually make the choice, thus rendering all the costs and efforts of seeking variety redundant. And in the final section, let's look at some strategies to manage the undesirable impacts of affective misforecasting and to use it to our advantage. We can improve the mental construction of future scenarios by firstly thinking about peripheral or non-focal events that might occur simultaneously and distract us from the anticipated event. Secondly, referring more thoroughly to past experiences similar to the focal event. Third, considering concrete and minor details of the anticipated event, process of achieving it, and different configurations of these details that are possible. And lastly, evaluating one option at a time and not multiple scenarios at once. Also, we must be aware that we overestimate the intensity of our emotional reactions to events that we perceive to be important to our needs and goals. Next, certain aspects of personality can influence the accuracy of affective forecasts. Firstly, people who score high on emotional management ability, a component of emotional intelligence, recognize their ability to regulate emotions and adapt to affective events, leading them to make more accurate forecasts. Secondly, people who score high on neuroticism tend to overestimate the impact of negative experiences, while people who score high on extraversion tend to overestimate the impact of positive experiences. Also, accuracy of affective forecasts improves with age, and this could be attributed to lower levels of immune neglect and higher emotional intelligence. Next, impact bias was found to be stronger in Western cultures compared to Eastern ones, possibly because of higher levels of focal thinking in the West. And finally, practicing mindfulness to develop an appreciation of how fleeting and ever-changing our emotions are can help improve our forecasting abilities. And to conclude, let's look back at the story of the three men venturing into the zone. As they approach the room that grants wishes, the writer and the professor wonder whether they are ready to find out their deepest desires and how they'll react when they do. Go watch this hypnotic, philosophical parable to find out what fate awaits these two men in the room. Remember to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment. And before the libertarian paternalists come to nudge you, you better go nudge yourself. See you next time.